Hello, and welcome to Faith Invest in Conversation. I'm Nana Francois, Director of Membership here at Faith Invest, and I'd like to introduce in a moment my colleague, Mike Evan, and our speaker today, Shaunaka, who's coming to us from the Oxford Center for Hindu Studies.
As Nana said, I'm Mike Evan. I'm saying hello to all of you from Boston today, and I am Faith Invest Director of Research. And Shaunaka, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much, and a pleasure to be with you both.
So Shaunaka is not only one of our trustees, he also leads a Hindu Studies Center in Oxford.
Shaunaka, please take us from the beginning, how a nice Irishman like you came to be director of the Oxford Center for Hindu Studies, which has been going strong for many years and pioneering many things within the faith.
Yeah, thank you, Nana. It's a kind of a strange journey. How do you get from being an Irish Catholic to a Hindu priest? But interestingly, ever since I was a child, since about the age of 7, I wanted to be a priest. It was just in a Catholic context. And I did become a priest. It's just in a different tradition. And my father had given me blessings to search for myself and find for myself truth, the truth for me, and find principles that were very important to me as a person, and that I would follow them all my life. And he said, then you can respect yourself. And that meant more to him than aligning yourself with this faith or that faith. He thought faith very important, but without these principles, he didn't see how I was going to grow as a person. And he said that to me on his deathbed, actually, when I was 15 years old. And that set me off on a journey that I felt very blessed to do. And I looked into all kinds of traditions, including my Catholic tradition, obviously. So in finding a Hindu tradition that spoke about love of God, which was what I was reading in the Catholic tradition, I decided to join a Hindu ashram to get trained up in that tradition. And interestingly, I joined to become a Christian, ironically. This was the best expression of Christianity that I could find. Because I joined from that point of view, in a sense, I was having a multicultural experience with myself and a multi-faith experience with myself. And so I had to question myself on many different levels. And I joined the ashram. I lived in an ashram for 13 years, and that's a bit of a commitment. But it was a very important experience in my life, very enjoyable. During that time, I opened a Hindu temple in Belfast in North Ireland during the Troubles. I got very involved in interfaith dialogue, partly because that's what was happening within myself. And through those contacts, I just started to broaden my perspectives, basically. Eastern Europe and Russia opened up at that time, and I was sent by my society to help those little Hindu communities in those areas to develop their relationships with the establishment, with the churches, the new governments, and new perspectives. Very, very interesting experiences for me, all very educational. I got involved in education within my own society, my own ashram, in terms of not only interfaith, but communications in general at all levels of society. As I said, that just led me to meet tons of people. And I was at a conference giving a presentation in Cambridge in 1996, and I got introduced to some scholars. And one of them from Oxford said, we'd like to start a Center for Hindu Studies in Oxford. Would you like to start it? More or less. I kind of thought it through, and I realized what was being offered. And really what was being offered was the community in the UK, shall we say, was being offered a seat in the establishment, you know, to be recognized as, you know, you should come and study your own tradition critically and look at it from all angles of vision and examine it for what it is. That can be quite challenging for many faith communities, but it's been done very successfully by many. And I felt very positive about it. So that's what we started.
Faith Invest is very purposefully inclusive of all sorts of faiths and traditions. I was wondering if you'd tell us just a little bit about the structure of the Hindu faithful. Is it centralized? How do you represent Hindus in England? Who do you report to someone, so to speak? Is there an organized structure around your efforts?
Yeah, it's very interesting question. In the early 80s, I was sent to a meeting with the National Council of Hindu Temples from Ireland to England, where there were hardly any Indians in Ireland at that time, a lot in the UK. I thought this is a national representative body. And when I got there, it was a very small group of people around a table in a temple. a very small temple. And I realized that there were about six such representative bodies. So there is no central organization to Hinduism. This was an introduction to Hinduism for me, because in the Irish context, we were the Hindus. And here you were going meeting Gujarati Hindus, Bengali Hindus, Tamil Hindus, Punjabi Hindus, Bengali Hindus, just so many different types. And not only types of religion, but cuisine and language. I mean, it's really, really diverse. And that helped me to understand that this idea of pluralism that they have in Indian culture, it translates into organizational structure, or lack of it, shall we say. So there are sadhus, holy people that people cluster around and who start movements and who start into institutions. But it's their enlightenment, their spirituality that people are attracted to. But there's no one body. There's no pope. There's no church. There's no one book. There are hundreds of books. There are hundreds of leaders, hundreds of commentators and enlightened people that you can get involved with. Coming from a Irish kind of European perspective, it was a real eye-opener as to how many people on the planet, I mean, billions of people have interacted with each other for millennia. And I wasn't aware that this was even possible, that you could interact like this, that you could organize yourself like this. But the thing is, things are organized. So there's the Kumbh Mela, a festival that isn't advertised anywhere, that people come to in the millions. They just know when it's on. It's according to the moon. And they just arrived there. The last one, there was over 15 million people came to it. That was the Maha Kumbh Mela, which meant it's the one that happens every 144 years. So what kind of institutional memory is that? And there isn't an institution. So what's the dynamic? How do these people work? And that's something we haven't addressed in the Western context. It's another reason why the Center for Hindu Studies at Oxford was very important, because in a Western intellectual context, we kind of insist that people think the way we do. And that's really not globalization, is it? You know, it's kind of, we don't understand that people have been thinking quite successfully in cultural terms and highly intellectual terms for an awfully long time. And we need to study that and value that and see if that has global relevance before we dismiss it or try and supplant it, which is essentially colonialism. And I found in working in academia that academia is one of the last bastions of colonialism in a kind of unconscious way. We have certain assumptions in a Western context, philosophical assumptions that we superimpose on the planet. It's amazing that we get away with it. But in a global context, it's not right. That doesn't make any sense at all. And it doesn't allow people to express themselves as they need to create the global atmosphere that we need to create. And this falls very much into Faith Invest, where you're looking multiculturally. Well, how do you look at multiculturalism? What's your, the Sanskrit word is darshan. What's your vision? What's your way of seeing? And in Indian culture, it's recognized that every single individual on the planet has a different way of seeing, because they're looking from a different perspective, even physically, what to speak of emotionally or intellectually or spiritually. So there are as many religions, philosophies, ways of seeing as there are people. And that kind of thinking we have to bring into Faith Invest as well. Here's so many ways of seeing and as many as there are people. So that kind of multicultural, multi-faith, multi-ethnic, multi-everything perspective. But that's the pluralism we've always been looking for in the West. And with Faith Invest, we should be the same about investment. We should really look very, very broadly at the picture. And we know that the economy is, we're going into a recession now. We've been in a recession. Everything works in cycles. But we don't act like everything works in cycles. So have we joined up good thinking with investment practice? Or have we joined up global thinking with economic theories? And seems like sometimes we haven't. We have everything to play for in this new field if we're truly global and truly multicultural.
Shaunaka, we're definitely going to want to follow up with you in a second on the specific implications of Hindu belief system and some examples. But before I do that, one last kind of pragmatic, if you will, question. Tell us a little bit about the Hindu global population. I'm assuming, perhaps incorrectly, that it's centered in India. Are there other significant centers?
Hindu global population is at least a billion people. About 30 million of them are in the diaspora. And that has grown from the 1970s, when it was pretty minuscule, actually, where it's really taken off and taken hold in many countries. And in places like America and in England and in Australia, the communities are possibly the most well-educated, wealthiest ethnic communities in those countries. So they've really grown and done very, very well indeed. And you see them represented at the highest levels of commerce and industry and technology. So it's a very interesting community. And in terms of wealth creation, we know that the Indian community per se, the Hindu community included with the Jains and the Buddhists and the Sikhs, are doing exceptionally well globally in terms of wealth creation. So they are people who have money worth investing, and all kinds of asset managers are chasing their tails, trying to engage them. The Indian community are global players without doubt.
And it was interesting what you said earlier about the Hindu traditions teaching us to have many different perspectives about key topics and being open to understand. And maybe you could just talk us through specifically how the Hindu traditions or the Hindu approach might address something that is topical or close to our hearts right now, the whole concept of ESG investing or impact investing, or looking at multiple levels of benefits beyond pure financial return.
From a Hindu point of view, and this would often include Buddhists and Jains and Sikhs as well, and even Taoists, I mean, the whole of the East has share certain ways of thinking. But you can't take without giving. Everything is a cycle. From a religious point of view, I go to a temple. I don't go just to ask for something. I actually go and give something before I would dare ask, just to show I'm part of a cycle here. I can't just take. So everything has to work in balance. So if I'm going to make an awful lot of money, and my desire is to make more money, then if I'm investing in a way that helps other people, I'm giving and taking at the same time. I've created a balance in the transaction. Mm-hmm. And that's just kind of common sense. Another way of thinking that exclusively Hindu is the nature of the self, that we are eternal individuals. So I'm not a human being looking for a spiritual experience. I'm a spiritual being having a human experience. So my spirituality is beyond my humanity. It's beyond my maleness. It's beyond my white skin. It's beyond my religion. These are all temporary things. And I'm just passing through this phase, this life. We are eternal by nature, and we're full of joy and full of bliss. We just forgot it. So how do we get back to who we are? So recognizing that all living beings are the same, have this same nature. We're all looking for happiness, and we're just all caught in different bodies. So I might have a Rolls Royce body compared to a termite, which has a mini minor body, you know, whatever, however we categorize it. But I'm not going to be speciesist about it. It's this broad concept. It's beyond racism, beyond sexism. It's even beyond speciesism. You know, the humans, we're not extra special. You know, we're pretty good, but we shouldn't conduct ourselves in such a way that we disadvantage other forms of life. And if we look at our legal systems since the Enlightenment, we've developed legal systems that are all about the dignity of the human being. Human dignity is the issue. Whereas from a traditional Hindu point of view, it would be the dignity of all life. Now imagine if that was the basis of our legal system. It wouldn't be just about humans. It means that you could bring people to court if they were disadvantaging tigers and elephants and all kinds of endangered species. You wouldn't get that far, because these are also citizens of the planet we have a responsibility to take care of. Again, there's a breadth of thinking there that leads directly to environmental policy and all kinds of other social policies. So these ways of thinking are very broad, very profound, but also means when I'm investing, how am I investing my money and what impact is it having on other living beings? Well, we talk about impact on the planet, which is kind of an impersonal conceptual idea. Let's make it personal. Let's put a face on it. So every other living being How are we interacting with them in terms of my investing potential? Am I disadvantaging them? Am I killing them? Am I eradicating them from the planet altogether? So these are proper questions to ask if you're thinking that all life is special, not just human life. So then how am I investing my money and what kind of impact does it have in the bigger picture? So I look at the potential investment and I see what are they doing to minimize harm, this kind of harm. And then how do I invest in that to build up that sector so that we understand that we can minimize harm? And that's one of the interesting things about Faith Invest. If you start talking like this among spiritually minded people of many religions, they'll all kind of get it. And then we can collectively say, let's not invest in these things. Let's invest in these things. That collective approach is extremely powerful. That's the power everyone understands on the planet. It comes from a very quiet power, a very kind of soft power, as they call it. But its impact can be very, very strong. And that's just about taking care of each other. It's about compassion. It's about tolerance. It's about thoughtfulness. These are all good things. So by investing like that, you're investing in these good qualities, these virtues, and you're saying these virtues are worthwhile. And that's a huge statement to make, because our investment policy can actually favor the kind of virtues that our traditions are trying to promote. So we can all work together promoting good virtues with a broader vision like this. And Hinduism can really help with that. And as I say, other traditions as well. It doesn't exclude other traditions. And that's, I think, why we can work together.
I certainly don't want to oversimplify, but it sounds to me like one of your key points is that Hinduism, it's all tied in together. The things we call social impact, the things we call environmental impact, are all really very, very much combined in the thought process of Hindu beliefs.
Yes, this idea of interconnectedness, interaction, interdependence is very fundamental to Hinduism. None of us are disconnected in reality. We're all part of a much bigger machine. This is a very fundamental Hindu thought. It's a concept called Ritta, which means cosmic order, that we're born into a cosmic order, something that pre-exists us. When we leave, it'll still be here. So we're only a very small part of a greater whole. And then the natural thought is, well, what is my duty? What is the thing I should do to make a contribution? And if we don't do anything, we're detracting. And if we do something that is thoughtless of what our contribution should be, we're also detracting. So we should consciously look for what is the thing I should do that's the best thing to do? What is my individual contribution? And it's also where the idea, another expansion of the pluralist idea in Indian thought, because every single individual has their own contribution to make, and we all have to find our own dharma, our own way of doing things, of doing the right thing and doing it right. So that's kind of inherent in all of us to do. And interestingly, the idea of dharma isn't necessarily even about God. It's just about how to act in the world, how to make a contribution. It's always about others. That way of thinking, it means that I'm immediately connected with everyone, and everyone's connected with me. So any way that I can empower another person, rather than detract from them, is contribute to them, to be their servant, essentially. So this idea from Ritta means that I am essentially a servant of the greater whole. As an investor, I am the servant of the funds that have been given to me. It's my service to distribute this, to manage this, to invest this. So how do I do it in a way that serves the greater whole, the greater good? And how do I find things to invest in that are worthwhile, worthy, that will help other people?
I'm sorry to interrupt. I want to take that. You gave me a perfect lead-in. You had a lot of foresight in trying to do exactly that, in trying to translate some of these Hindu beliefs into actual actions in the investment world. And I know that the effort took a lot of your time. It was very interesting, but also had a lot of challenges. Do you mind telling us a little bit about that?
This is the Dow Jones thing?
Yes, please.
We were approached by a company that was representing Dow Jones. They wanted to develop a Hindu index. we were a bit bemused because we're an academic center and we had nothing to do with finance at all. We thought, okay, let's give this a go. And we contacted a number of our scholars. We got together with the finance people and asked them, well, what do you want? What are we looking for? And they wanted us to discern the principles behind an index for the Dow Jones. So we put thought into it and we came up with a document. Well, the first thing actually we did was we convinced them not to do a Hindu index, but a Dharma index, because the idea of Dharma, of doing the right thing, shall we say, is shared by Hindus, Buddhists, Jains, and Sikhs. So they took that. So we got about 25 scholars involved, Buddhist, Jain, Hindu, Sikh, for all around the world, and we developed this with them. So it was quite an effort, and got everyone to sign off on it, which is practically I don't know, impossible that we did it. And then we developed for them an advisory board of religious leaders. So we got the main Hindu religious leaders to get involved and sign off on it, and an academic advisory board, which were the people who developed it. We did a huge launch in Mumbai that went very well for what it was. We weren't on the finance side at all, but they used the principles to look at negative, positive screening and all that, which was the thing to do in the day. We weren't talking as much about things like impact investment, etc. It was an interesting experience, and it's led me to be involved in FaithInvest, because we all realized actually this was a good thing to do. Who else was going to do it? And they had nowhere else to turn, because Hinduism doesn't have a center. So yeah, they thought, well, let's go to something that's authoritative, shall we say. Susie's asking what happened to the Dharma Index. Susie, it imploded miserably. It was a total disaster. And it wasn't to do with the potentiality of it. I think they could still do it. But the company that was running it, kind of with the Dow Jones banner, imploded due to internal politics, which had nothing to do with us and nothing to do with the Dow Jones. So the Dow Jones contacted us and said, could we get it going? You know, would we take up the slack? And we just said, sorry, we're an academic institution. Really not going to get involved in this.
The amazing thing about the effort was that you tried to tackle two challenges that hold a tremendous amount of promise and are extremely challenging as challenges. The first is the fact that many religions are decentralized, and coming up with a solution that works for a lot of the faithful is difficult because of that. And the second is that the faithful are perhaps the most powerful force behind religions when it comes to investing of their own direct funds. And yet it's very hard to activate that in any kind of cohesive way. So, yeah. So I think the project was very significant in trying to drive that forward.
Yeah.
And shows both some of the potential and some of the challenges of the effort.
Well, it absolutely does. I mean, it was a pioneering effort, without doubt. That's why it was valuable in and of itself. But the fact that we got the academic community so broadly involved, and the fact that we got the Hindu religious leadership, I mean, very conservative people on the whole, to endorse it, was very helpful, because it was even just the array of spiritual leadership. It was people from all different types of denominations. It showed the potentiality. It, you know, what could be possible. And there was take up, as much as the company worked, there was take up, and part of it was this. It had this academic weight and this spiritual weight to it. And it also had a good vehicle, a good financial vehicle. So it can be done. There's, you know, work to be done, but it can be done.
Just thinking about, as you say, from such a strong foundation of having many different traditions working together to create that spiritual foundation, where do you think the conversation should be going from here? What do you see that's interesting, that's driven by the academic world? Where do you think collaboration efforts should really, really be focused?
In a very kind of Hindu way, and it's something that Mike mentioned about interconnectivity, the fact is that the academic world and the spiritual world and the investment world and the political world and the social world are all connected. And to pretend they're not is just nonsense, really. You know, it's like trying to separate our head from our heart. We have the intellectual and we have the social need and we have the spiritual people. And, you know, we have the asset managers, and we have the politicians, and they all have to work together. But the thing is that the spiritual side, the religious side, they really have a responsibility to push this forward. It's a very fundamental responsibility, because it's very important that if I'm preaching peace and love and you know, ahimsa in Hindi and all that kind of stuff, and I'm investing in arms and ammunition and pornography and, you know, cow killing if I'm a Hindu and all that kind of stuff, then who am I as a person? And I go back to my father telling me to find principles that mean something to me and then follow them, and then I can respect myself. I have to be fully conscious of what I'm investing in, because it's a part of me. It's not a different thing. You know, the investment world isn't separate from my spirituality or my religious quest. So it's very much incumbent on thoughtful, spiritually minded people to show that spirituality, exemplify it in the world that we live in, so people can see what spirituality is when it hits the ground. And they see that people aren't hypocrites. It's very easy if someone's trying to follow principles to, you know, point out the dirt on their shoes. But let's clean our shoes. You know, let's not invest in this stuff. Let's invest positively. Invest in things that are going to help the environment, are going to help social need, are going to contribute to the common good, are going to help in terms of discrimination. And whatever we can do to develop capacity for people leading better lives, that with better education and better infrastructure and better homes. And we can do something about that. You know, the world can be a miserable place for a lot of people, and we can help. So if that's what our quest is, let's just do it. Why not? So we should, on the grassroots level, we should ask our pastors and our imams and our Brahmins and our rabbis and say, how is our church investing its funds? What good is that investment doing? How can we do better? Is there any mechanism? Is there any process? Can we continue to look for something? Enough communities get together, you have a fair old pool of money. It's worth investing. There's things that we can do that are very positive, that really come from the heart. And for politicians, it may not be from the heart, but the politicians will act if there's a groundswell like this. Politicians will also act if the asset managers act, and the asset managers will act if the people giving in the assets act. It's all interconnected. So what's the first thing? The first thing is the people who hold the assets say to the asset managers, I don't want to invest in this stuff. I would prefer to invest in this stuff. Please find me options.
Last question for me that dives from the beautiful spiritual speech you just gave to the dollars and cents question. As you know, the main goal of Faith Invest is to increase the focus on exactly the kind of investing that you're talking about. And one of the challenges is that the assets to be invested are very spread out. They're in many places that are almost invisible, both to the outside world and certainly to the investment world. I know that the Hindu assets are very dispersed, and I know there's not a lot of knowledge about them. Could you philosophize a bit with us about what those assets might be and where they might be and how they are handled today?
Because Hinduism isn't centralized, and there are a lot of big temples in Hinduism, the Tirupati temple is exceedingly wealthy. A number of these temples are run by government civil servants who have to run the temple because they're so big and so wealthy. But they have a lot of money that could be attracted to investment and is at the moment being spent on impact investment and has been for generations in terms of building schools and hospitals and things like that. It is possible to contact some temples and start a conversation with them. The bigger issue is not actually the Hindu institutions. It is with Hindu practitioners who are high net worth individuals, who are corporate directors. A lot of Hindu businesses or Indian businesses are family run businesses, and they run in a family run model that's unique. It's not, we don't find it in the West. So these family groups will often be Hindu or Jain, and that will be their ethos, and that will be their declared ethos. They have money that is eminently investable, a lot of it. And it's a matter of contacting those people and getting them to start seeing why it's important for them to invest. If someone at a certain level does it, then it becomes a knock-on effect. And a number of Hindus at that level are very interested, and they've been doing courses in America and different places on philanthropy. Hindus have money and they're wondering what to do with it and thinking of different ways and how to manage it. So I think there's tremendous potential, but I wouldn't focus on the temples. That's not where the real money is. It's also not where the real opportunity is in terms of educating people of wealth, and by doing that, changing the culture. And I think part of the cultural change in an Indian context is helping Indians be more aware of their own cultural heritage with regard to issues of distribution of wealth creation, of philanthropy, of altruism. And they're very much embedded in all the texts. It's just that we haven't really researched them from this perspective. And if you help people understand that this is in the literature of your country and your culture, and then get them to reflect on that, along with courses they'll do in Yale and Harvard and Wharton on philanthropy, then it's even more interesting for them, and it's more emotional push. It gives them something to say, okay, I'll do this, not because a guy in Harvard says it and it is a good idea, but actually because there's a way of doing it that people in my culture have practiced for a long time, and I just didn't know. And generally, on the whole, our country forgot, because we go into the international markets who don't care about Hinduism. So who's going to help them understand their own culture's approach to these things? And that's an educational issue. It's a research issue. And then people can teach it, and people will get it. These are highly motivated, very intelligent, very well-educated people.
Shaunaka, I want to thank you so much for sharing your wisdom and your insights. Yes. And for helping us all to understand a little bit about what the Hindu traditions can teach us about looking at things differently from multiple perspectives, and seeing how difference can also help us collaborate together.
Shaunaka, that was absolutely wonderful.